In this video, we have only one objective, which is to calculate the concentration of electrons and holes in a piece of silicon. As we will see later, this is instrumental to finding the conductivity of the material. So to start calculating quantitative models for the number of electrons and holes in a semiconductor, we have to start by something called the Fermi-Dirac function. The Fermi-Dirac function is shown here. This is a probability density function. So it represents the probability of finding an electron at a certain energy level. And so it is a function of the energy level E. And the x-axis here is the probability level. So it is fairly certain, it is really probable that we will find electrons in the valence band. It is a lot less probable that we will find electrons in the conduction band. So probability drops from 1 towards null as we increase in energy. It is important to notice that the Fermi-Dirac function is a conditional probability. It tells us what is the probability that we will find an electron at a certain level, given that there is a valid energy state for the electron to reside in at that level. And so you will find that the Fermi-Dirac function has a finite value within the forbidden gap. So for this whole range, you'll find the Fermi-Dirac function has a finite value. That this doesn't mean that we will have electrons at these levels. All it means is if there are levels within the forbidden gap, which there are not, there is a probability of finding electrons that is this much. So as we said, the probability drops precipitously from the valence band down to the conduction band. There's a certain level which generally lies within the forbidden gap at which the probability is half. So this is the level at which it is equally probable that we will find an electron and not find an electron. Again, in reality, at this level, we will never find an electron because this level, this energy value, lies within the forbidden gap. It is not an actual energy level. But this value, EF, is actually important because it is one of the parameters of the Fermi-Dirac function. So the Fermi-Dirac function has two parameters, temperature, T, and this energy level, EF. This energy level, EF, is called the Fermi level. And it is critically important because it is a good indicator of the types and concentrations of charged carriers in a material. So it is critically important that we keep track of the Fermi level. Now, what is the effect of temperature on the shape of the Fermi-Dirac function? If we look at these curves, these are the curves for the Fermi-Dirac function at different temperature levels, T. Obviously, as we increase T, the tail of the function in the conduction band, which is this area, will increase. The more the temperature, the more the tail that extends into the conduction band. This tail is very important because it is a representation of the actual number of electrons that managed to make it from the valence band to the conduction band. Also, as the tail increases in the conduction band, there will be a tail that increases in the valence band. This tail that increases in the valence band represents the amount of energy levels or energy states that are now empty, because this tail is now 1 minus P of E. So it represents the probability that we will not find electrons in the valence band. In the previous video, we talked about the fact that lack of electrons in the valence band means a charge carrier, because lack of an electron in the valence band means we have a hole. Presence of an electron in the conduction band means that we have a charge carrier, because if we have an electron in the conduction band, that's a charge carrier. So when temperature increases, the tail increases in both the conduction band and the valence band, meaning that we have more holes and more electrons, which makes sense because for an electron to be generated in the conduction band, it has to have jumped from the valence band. So that means that it has to have left behind a hole. So we can conclude in general that N, the concentration of electrons in the material, the number of electrons per centimeter cube, is going to be equal to P, the concentration of holes in the material. This is a fact, and it is valid for pure silicon only. So it is valid for pure silicon, because to generate an electron, we have to have generated a hole along the way. Notice that sometimes electrons also jump down from the conduction band. In that case, we say that they have recombined, because when they go down, they recombine with the hole that they left behind originally, and this leads to the annihilation of both the electron and the hole as the electron returns back to its covalent bond. The two processes, recombination and generation, happen in any material all the time. What matters is the valence level between them, which gives us the valence level of electrons and holes in the material. And it is obviously a function of temperature, as we can see from this graph. Now, let's imagine that we have a piece of silicon and we want to calculate the concentration of electrons, N, in this material. N is the number of electrons per centimeter cube, so it's the volumetric density of electrons in the material. As we said, the probability function P of E, the Fermi-Dirac function, is not the probability that we will find an electron at a certain energy level. It is a conditional probability. It means we will find an electron at this level if this level exists. So what is the probability, what is the presence or lack thereof an energy level? There's something called the density of states function, and the density of states function represents how many energy levels per centimeter cube exist at a certain energy level. So in the conduction band and in the valence band, there is a certain density of states. So in the valence band, for example, the density of states NVB of E is equal to 4 pi over h cube, where h is the Planck constant, times mh to the power of half, to the power of 3 over 2, pardon, square root EV minus E. Now we have to explain what this expression means and what some of the parameters in it mean. EV is the edge of the conduction band, of the valence band, so it's the highest level in the valence band. E is the energy level at which we are looking. So obviously the density of states in the valence band is a function of the energy level. So the density of states at this level is different from at this level. Density of states is measured in centimeter power minus 3. It's number of density of states available per centimeter cube. MH is something called the effective density of the effective mass of holes. So this is the effective mass of holes. It is equal to the mass of an electron, more or less, but it is adjusted to account for two things. To account for the fact that the valence band electrons are moving through a crystal and that they are moving through the crowded valence band through covalent bonds. So it's an effective mass. It is not exactly the mass of the electron. It is a bit higher to account for the impediments that this electron sees as it moves through the valence band. Recall that holes are virtual particles and that in reality what is moving is still electrons. So this is the density of states in the valence band. Now, these states are just exist. Whether or not there are electrons in them is a question that is answered by the probability density function P of E. However, in the valence band, we are not interested in the availability of electrons. What we are interested in is actually the lack of electrons, because that is what gives us holes. And so for a certain energy level, we should multiply 1 minus P of E multiplied by NVB of E. And what that gives us is the concentration of holes at a certain energy level. But we are not interested in the concentration of holes at certain energy level within the valence band. We are interested in the concentration of holes in the entire material. And so we should integrate over the entire valence band from minus infinity all the way up to EV dE. And that gives us the concentration of holes P small, number of holes per centimeter cube. Likewise, in the conduction band, we have a function NCB of E, which is the concentration or density of states in the conduction band. And NCB of E is going to be is going to have two parameters, like NCB of E. One of them is the effective density of electrons, which is ME. So it's a very similar equation. And the other is EC, which is the edge of the conduction band, the lowest energy level in the conduction band. Using a similar discussion, the probability that we find an electron at such an energy level is P of E. And so the concentration of electrons at a certain energy level is P of E times NCB of E. But we want to find electrons in the entire conduction band, so we integrate over the entire conduction band, which happens to be from EC to infinity. It is useful to see these integral equations graphically. So here we are showing the probability density function, P of E, the Fermi-Dirac function, the density of states in the valence band and the conduction band, and the products. So in the first graph, this is P of E, the probability of finding electrons. For holes, we want to actually look at 1 minus P of E, because this is the probability of not finding electrons. NCB of E, the concentration of density, the density of states in the conduction band has this form, and the density of states in the valence band has this form. So there are less energy levels available near the conduction band edge and the valence band edge, and more available deeper into the bands. Now, we are interested in the product of this graph by this graph. The product will start at null near the edges of the bands, because the concentration, the density of states is very small, and will end up also at a null because the corresponding probabilities go towards null and there's a peak in the middle. So this represents the density of electrons and holes at the different energy levels. The entire concentration of electrons in the conduction band is the area under this curve, which is its integration. The entire concentration of holes in the valence band is the integration, which is the area of this curve. We can see that the two curves are more or less equal, which proves that, which shows that N is equal to P in a pure piece of silicon. We'll prove that a little bit more rigorously in the next video.